Streaming live. If you will meet me in 2 Kings chapter 7. Thanks be unto God who gives unto us his inexpressible gift, the gift of our Lord and Savior Jesus, who is undoubtedly the Christ, the Son of the living God. 2 Kings chapter 7, I want to read in your hearing. It may say verses 1 through 20 in your bulletins, but we're going to just read verses 1 through 9, and I'll be reading from the King James Version. If you have the King James Version, you'll find these holy, divine, and inspired words. Then Elisha said, "Hear ye the word of the Lord. Thus said the Lord, tomorrow about this time shall a measure of fine flour be sold for a shekel, and two measures of barley for a shekel in the gate of Samaria." Then a lord on whose hand the king leaned answered the man of God and said, "Behold, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, might this thing be?" And he said, "Behold, because you doubted me, behold, thou shalt see it with your eyes, but you shall not eat thereof." And worse than that gonna happen to him. I'm gonna show you that in the scripture. "And there were four leprous men at the entering in of the gate. And they said one to another, 'Why sit we here until we die? If we say we will enter the city, then the famine is in the city, and we shall die there. And if we sit still here, we still gonna die. Now therefore come and let us fall unto the host of the Syrians. If they save us alive, we shall but live. And if they kill us, we shall but die.' And they rose up in the twilight to go into the camp of the Syrians. And when they were come to the othermost part of the camp of Syria, behold, there was no man there." Verse 6 says, for the Lord had made the host of the Syrians. You got to underline, highlight, circle this. The Lord made the host of the Syrians to hear a noise of chariots and a noise of horses and even the noise of a great host. And they said one to another, "Lo, the king of Israel hath hired against us the king of the Hittites and the king of the Egyptians to come upon us. Wherefore they arose and fled in the twilight. And they left their tents and their horses and their asses, even the camp as it was, and fled for their life. And when these lepers came to the othermost part of the camp, they went in into one tent, did eat and drink, and carried thence silver and gold and raiment. They had hookups, and they went and hid it. And they came again and entered into another tent, and carried thence also, and they went and hid there too. Then they said one to another, 'Wait a minute, we do not well. This day is a good day of good tidings, and here we are holding our peace. If we tarry to the morning light, some mischief will come upon us. Now therefore come that we may go and tell the king's household the word of God.'" But just a few minutes on this first Sunday, my brothers and sisters, of this new year in 2017, from those verses and this chapter, we want to start 2017, Sister Alicia Patton, by preaching on the subject, if you will, "Why sit we here? Why sit we here?" In the days of Elisha, King Ben-Hadad of Syria decided to crowd around Samaria, which was the capital city of Israel. His strategy, Reverend Jackson, was to surround the city with thousands of his troops. And in doing so, he would cut off the supplies that would normally be brought in to the city. So effective, Deacon Andrew Williams Jr., was his strategy as he besieged the city month after month, a great famine ensued. It was so brutal, according to 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 25, that an ass's head sold for 80 shekels of silver. Let me read that to you, if you will, and you will see it on the screen from the Living Bible. Let me tell you how hard times was. It says, 2 Kings 6:25 says from the Living Bible, Andy, and as a result, there was a great famine in the city, and after a long while, even a donkey's head sold for $50, and a pint of Dubs, blunk, 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 sold for $3. Now, you think you got it bad. If they selling a donkey's head for $50 and they selling a pint of Dub droppings, it's tight. It's tight. Let me show you how tight it was. Look at me, if you will, on the screen. Let me look at verses 6 through verse 29 of 2 Kings chapter 6. Let me show you how bad it had gotten. Verse 26 says, and as the king of Israel was passing upon the wall, there cried a woman unto him, saying, help me, my lord, O king. And he said, if the Lord do not help thee, whence shall I help thee? He said, out of the barn floor or out of the wine press? And the king, let me show you how bad it got. And the king said unto her, said, what aileth thee? And she answered and said, this woman said unto me, give thy son that we may eat him today, and then we'll eat mine on tomorrow. It's right there in the scripture. So we boiled my son and did eat him. And then I said it to her on the next day, give me your son. And then she talking about we can't find him. It's right there in the scripture. Times was tight. They were hard, as daddy would say when we were little. Daddy said, 1929, mama, times was so hard. Rats were standing on the corner crying, eating onions because there wasn't no cheese. That's tight, brethren. So you see, Mike, that it was very tight on these people. So tight that they were eating donkey's heads. They didn't know years later we'd be eating hog head cheese, but it was so tight that they were eating Dove droppings. It was so tight that they were eating each other's kids. It wouldn't have been a good time back then for you to have a thick jaw. Riley, I don't know if you'd have made it, brother. In the midst of this devastating famine, a group of lepers decided that it made no sense for them to continue to sit outside the city wall where scraps of food would be thrown their way. You see, according to Leviticus chapter 13, verses 45 and 46, the lepers, what they had to do, Trevon, they had to put a covering over their upper lip. And they had to stand away from the crowd and they had to yell, unclean! And thank you. And they had to live outside of the camp. So they said, well, let's go to the Syrian camp. They said, maybe they'll show mercy to us because we're going to die anyway. What do we have to lose? You see, now, brothers and my sisters, when you get desperate enough, you don't mind breaking protocol. When you get desperate enough, you don't mind breaking tradition. Desperate measures call for desperate means. And since we about to die, this ain't no time to be politically correct. So since we're gonna die whether we here or whether we there, at least let us try there where they got some bread. So verse 6 says, as they made the journey across the field, what they didn't know that the Lord had done a miracle. Watch this, Delvin. That same evening, he had caused, watch me now, he had caused the Syrians to hear the sound of a horse. They didn't see one, y'all. He caused them to hear the sound of a chariot. They didn't see one. He caused them to hear the sound of soldiers. And hearing the sound of a huge army approaching, the Syrians panicked. I'm so glad that I got a God that can whoop you with a sound. Let me show you something. 2 Samuel, let me show you something. Let me show you something. I'm about to show you something. 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 22 and 24. Watch this. 2 Samuel. Watch what it says. It says, and the Philistines came up yet again and spread themselves in the valley of Rephaim. Remember, the Philistines were arch enemies of the Israelites, always fighting. And when David inquired of the Lord, watch what he said. He said, thou shalt not go up, but I need you to fetch a compass behind them and come up over against the mulberry trees. Y'all watch me. And let it be that when thou hearest the sound of a going in the tops of the mulberry tree, then you shall bestir yourself, for then shall the Lord go out before you to smite the host of the Philistines. Andrew, the folk didn't have a rifle, a bullet, a bow and arrow. God said, I tell you what, you sit still until you hear the sound of the mulberry trees. Okay. Judges chapter 7. Let me, Judges chapter 7, verse 20. And 21, I'm going somewhere. Judges chapter 7, verse 20 and 21. And these three companies blew the trumpets, and they brake the pitchers, and held the lamps in the left hand, and the trumpet in the right hand, to blow withal. And they cried, the sword of the Lord and Gideon. And they stood, every man in the place turned about the camp, and all the host ran, cried, and fled. Ain't nobody threw a punch. All they did was have a trumpet. All they did was blow the trumpet and cried the Lord of the sword of Gideon. And the men of Israel, look. And the 300 blew the trumpet. And the Lord said, every man's sword against his fellow, even throughout all the host. And the host fled and they ran because they were scared. What am I saying? You see, my brothers and my sisters, we don't know how to use praise as a weapon. These folk didn't have to shoot nobody. They didn't have to throw a rock. All they did was make some noise. And the reason your enemy ain't leaving you alone, you ain't making no noise. The Bible say, let's make a joyful noise unto the Lord. And you sitting there looking like something wrong with you. You need to praise God and say, go on with your bad self. You need to start making a noise. You see, when you make a noise, it confuses the devil. When the devil has put sickness in your body through God allowing him, when the devil has made you lose your job through God allowing him, he don't know how to deal with you because you still talking about praise God from whom all blessings flow. It confuses the enemy because he said, I don't know what to do with this person. I've done everything I need to do, and they still talking about thank you, Jesus. They still talking about God, I love you. See, the reason ain't nobody running from you because you ain't saying nothing. Because it don't make sense to you because you're too well educated and you're too well cultured to say that hallelujah stuff. God whooped these rascals with a sound. And we got the weapon of praise and sitting up there like we cute. Listen, if you cute before you praise them, you gonna be cute during and after you praise him. If you ain't cute before you praise him. So, Darius, God whooped them with a noise. They took off running, they panicked. So when the lepers cruised into the camp, they were shocked to find it totally deserted. food was bubbling over on the pots. Bread was sitting on the table. Lemonade was sitting in the refrigerator. Ice cream was in the ice box. Cookies was in the cabinet. They were amazed by the abundance of silver and gold and all the food. And the lepers, they went from tent to tent. They said, well, they might not have everything in this tent. So I'm going to check the other tents and see what other kind of food they got. They was feasting on the food, and they was finding gold, and they was hiding it. And finally, one of them looked at the other one and said, nah, y'all know this ain't right. What we doing ain't right, y'all. We must go back into the city, and we must spread this good news. So the scripture said they returned to the city. Bible Campbell, then they told the gatekeeper that the Syrian camp was deserted and that there was an abundance of food for everyone. And the king at first said, no, this sounds like a setup. So I tell you what I'm going to do with you. Said, I'm going to send 5 horses, and I'm going to send him 5 riders to check it out. He sent his 5 riders, his 5 people to check it out. They came back, and they verified the report. And then the people rushed through the gates, and there were so many people that they killed the king's right-hand man. Yeah, that's the same one in verse 2 said, this ain't going to happen. Yeah, it's a danger in not listening to the man of God when he told you what God said. Yeah, remember, he said, you'll see the food, but you can't eat it. Not only did he see it, he got trampled over and became food for the buzzards. Yeah, yeah. And then he died, and then they found that there was enough food to see him through. Their crops were restored. I see in this story, I see here Latrice, I see 3 applications of 3 groups of people. And in 2017, I want you to find yourself in the group that you belong in. Number one, Andrew, I see the diners rather than the doubters. The diners. The diners. When Elijah told the king that the famine would be over in 24 hours, the king's assistant scoffed, made fun of him. Man, please, that ain't gonna happen. And then Elijah said, I tell you what, you will see it, but you won't enter because of your disbelief. And then we see he end up getting trampled and getting killed. There are always people who are like this king's assistant. They ain't going to believe what they hear. You can tell them straight out the Bible, this is what God said. And they're going to say, yeah, but I don't believe that. I take my chance. Well, you keep taking it. Yeah, they don't believe what they hear. See, God's word tells us that he loves us. In fact, it says that he so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son to die for us, and that whosoever believes this will not perish, but will instead have everlasting life. People don't believe that. God's word says that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, yet we let people belittle us about our weight, our color, our looks, our lips, and our hips. No, 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 no. God is the one saying, you're fearfully and wonderfully made. They too big. They may be too big for you, but they just right for somebody else. God wants us to be the head and not the tail. And we satisfy with begging and renting. God says that you will be above only and not beneath. And we satisfy with being under the circumstances. God's word tells us that if we walk according to his statutes and judgments, that blessings would overtake us. And yet we believe more about the curses. God's word tells us that we are blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. And then folk thinking they got to leave their church to go to Shady Grove Baptist Church down the street to get the Holy Ghost. God's word said that no weapon formed against you shall prosper, and you keep running around time by day shooting at me.
and every lying tongue you shall condemn. God's word said, come unto me and rest, but you stay away from him and stress. God's word says that nothing shall be impossible, and with God all things are possible. And the first thing come out your lips, we can't do that. We see what God's word said, and yet many people, including Christians, act as if we don't believe a word of the very word we quote and read. My brothers and my sisters, in 2017, let us be diners rather than doubters. Let's feast upon the promises of God. 2 Corinthians 1:20 says, for all the promises of God in him are yes and amen. Don't you know that God already said yes to what he said yes to? Why are you praying for stuff he already said yes to? I know why. You don't know the promises. Why? Because you never come to Sunday school. You never come to Bible study. You don't even know what belongs to you in the word. You praying for stuff that's yours. Because the devil done tricked you that you know everything and don't nobody need to tell you what's in the Bible. You bought it hook, line, and sinker. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 2:14, now thanks be unto God which always causes us to triumph. Well, my question is, why are you always losing? Everything come out your mouth, the devil riding me, the devil on me, my car won't start, my furnace stopped. Child, you know the devil is busy. Well, God is busier. The reason you keep quoting the devil, because that proves who you've been hanging out with. Let's fill ourselves with the manna of the word and the milk and honey of the words. Let's fill ourselves on Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5 from the New Century Version. It said, every word of God is true. I don't care if you believe it. I don't care what you think. Every word of God is true. If God said it, that's it. Let's feed on Psalm 119, 160 that says, thy word, O God, is true from the beginning. Let's dine on Psalm 119, 89 that said, forever, Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. Let's dine on Isaiah 55:11 when God said, my word will not come back void. He said, it will prosper in the thing I sent it to, and it will always do what I sent it to do. Let's feast on Jeremiah 1:12 where God said, I will hasten my word to perform it. Bible contains 8,810 promises, and the average church person knows 3. But they can name every character on Basketball Wives. They can tell you when the people's birthday is. They can tell you what their favorite food is. They can tell you that she's a Capricorn, she's a Leo, she's a Sagittarius. But you can't find a scripture. And when you get sick, why don't you call the Basketball Wives and ask them? Let's be diners and not doubters. In 2017, let's not be like the people who refuse to believe. Let's not be like those who hear the word of God but refuse to put it in practice. Let's be not like those who know the principles of the word but don't apply them. Let's do like the psalmist that said, oh, baby, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Let us be diners and not doubters. Secondly, in 2017, the second group of people, I see the stepping outers rather than the sitting backers. The stepping outers. You ain't got to check the dictionary. It's a word. If I use it, it's a word. Rather than the sitting backers. See, maybe you're in a place where you feel leprous. No, maybe you don't have to cover your upper lip. And maybe you don't have to stand aside and yell unclean. But maybe you feel leprous in the sense that you too feel isolated. You too feel separated and famished and relegated to sitting outside the city. Well, let me help you. Maybe you're not literally sitting outside of the city, but maybe you're literally sitting outside of the promises. See, the promises is over there, and you sitting on the outside. Maybe you're not literally sitting on the outside of the city, but maybe you're on the outside of the covenant. Maybe you're on the outside of the blessings. Maybe you're on the outside of God's love. Maybe you're on the outside of God's joy. Maybe you're on the outside of God's peace. Maybe you're on the outside of God's comfort. Maybe you're on the outside of God's grace, and all you are is a window shopper looking in saying, I wish I could have enough faith to buy that miracle. You're on the outside, barely surviving on crumbs of hope. And here's the sad thing for those surviving on crumbs. Why is it that you are a child of God and all you have is crumbs, and the one you said is your father said, I am the bread of life? You mean you ain't got enough faith to make a loaf? Crumbs, Reverend. See, God's word is always telling us to step out. Abraham would be the father of the faithful. Through him, all the world would be blessed. But Abraham had to first do something, Trevon. The first thing he had to do was step out. God said, get thee out of your country and get away from your kinfolk and get away from your father's house into a land I'll show you. Jesus said to two brothers, Simon Peter and Andrew, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. But if you're going to follow me, you're going to have to leave those that you came to the fishing bank with. He told Matthew to follow me, but you're going to have to leave the tax booth. In order for Peter to walk on water, Jesus said, you first got to get out the boat. On the first day of 2017, my brothers and my sisters, what is Jesus telling you to step out on? Where is he telling you to take a chance with your safe self? Let me get closer to you. I said this morning, such things. Who do you have to leave to get to Canaan? Because just anybody can't go with you. That's why he told Abraham, leave your kinfolk. Who is he telling you to leave? Well, Reverend, I can't say because, like, I came to church with him. So. I'll tell you afterwards. I'll holler at you on the way home. Text me. See, let me tell you something. Faith is never learned in comfort. And for 52 Sundays, we're going to be talking about faith. If I don't mention faith, and every Sunday, y'all bring a guillotine and cut my head off right here. See, we learn faith, Sandy, when we are pressed. We learn faith when we're shaken. We learn faith when we're hurting. See, we learn faith when you're starving. You don't need faith if the refrigerator full. All you need is steps. See, we learn faith in the pit. That's where don't nobody want to go. We learn faith in the furnace when it's hot. We learn faith in the lion's den. See, we learn faith when the Red Sea is closed before us and we don't have a remote control opener. See, we learn faith in the breakup. We learn faith in the firing. We learn faith in the divorce. We learn faith in the pain. We learn faith in the misery. We learn faith in depression. We learn faith in discouragement. These are the places where faith is born. And here we get the nerve, God. I want you to increase my faith, but I don't want nobody to bother me. You see, always remember this. Faith honors God, and God honors faith. And you got to go through something to get it. These lepers had the faith to step out. They took a chance. If you feel like you're starving spiritually, I would encourage you to follow the leper's lead. I will encourage you to take a chance and step out in faith. I got a question for you. Why sit where you are and die? I mean, why sit in that nowhere going relationship until you die? Now, we've been together 20 years. You ain't grown spiritually. You ain't grown mentally. You ain't grown emotionally. You ain't grown financially. You ain't grown socially. You ain't grown psychologically. You ain't grown relationally. And I'm sitting there with you, just looking at you for 20 years. Well, you know, Pastor, he or she might change. Dude, sister. So you've been with him 30 years. So when you think, you know. So they moved from where they were when you met them. And now why do they? Listen, let me help you. If somebody's feeding you, you drive in their car, you can have sex with them and whoever else you want. In fact, you can have a car while they at work. You can have lipstick, makeup, and fingernails that don't belong to the one you're going with or staying with. Let me ask y'all something. Now, let me tell you something. He'd be fool to leave. Leave for what? I got free food, free sex, free rent, free cable, internet. I got your phone. Because see, ain't nothing in my name. So when they cut everything off, it ain't going to affect me. Because I came to the relationship without credit. Why would he leave? The people of yesteryear, the mothers of the church and the older folk used to say, listen here. Why in the world you expect him to buy a car when he can get the milk for free? He gonna change clothes that you bought him. I'm just, okay, y'all sit there and act like I ain't talking to nobody. I mean, now you can stay as long as you want. Now, I ain't saying get out. Just don't come see me talking about what I need to do. Stay there all day, do flips, cartwheels, just do whatever you want to do. But let me throw this in before I move. If you over 20 and somebody say that's my boyfriend or girlfriend, both of y'all need to be slapped. At that point, you need fiancés. Yeah, Beyonce wasn't lying. You need to put the... Look, I used to go with people when I was 8. I done graduated from college. I don't go with folk no more. I mean, it's serious. Like, oh, no. No, we ain't going together. We ain't boyfriend, girlfriend. This is not kindergarten. And the pledge that you gonna make me something is it. Now you put now, right here. It don't have to be Leo. It could be Leon, but you put something on it. Titanium. They make all kind of things. Sterling. Copper. Get a rubber band. Just put something on it. Work up to. If you can't get a diamond, get a Diamondique. They got fake stuff. Can't nobody see. I'll stand back. I'll wave from back here. But put something on it until you can put something else on it. If I do dishes with this, my whole hand turn green. But you stay there if you want. It's your relationship. Why sit at that same job going nowhere until you die? And you worked at that job 50 years, and you come home bragging, somebody gave me a watch. A watch. You gave him 50 years of your life and they done bought you a $125 watch and you doing a cartwheel? Ain't even the kind I like. Why sit in that ministry and continue to have one foot in and one foot out? Listen, if you're going to sing, sing. If you're going to dance, dance. If you're going to usher, black folk, usher. Now where we get that out from? If you're going to teach, teach. If you're going to preach, preach. If you're going to sweep, sweep. If you're going to greet, greet. If you got a rake ministry, rake. If you got a shovel ministry, shovel. You got a plowing ministry, plow. You got a healing ministry, heal something. You got a praying ministry? Pray for somebody. Do whatever your ministry is or get your butt out the way so somebody else can. They don't know when you're going to be on the meeting. They don't know when you're going to do this. You don't know who's going to be there. Everybody quit. I'd rather have you fully 100% committed to quitting than I'm going to do this 1 week. I'm going to not do that. Do all us a favor and sit your butt down. I'm just telling the truth. If you're going to do it, what I'm saying, do it. Don't be like a nasty mouth. Don't know you 1, 2, 5, 3. What? I mean, half time you're smiling, teeth missing, teeth back in. I don't know what to do. Y'all know I'm telling the truth. Reverend. I'm saying, y'all tell me he said quit. Yeah, I did. If you're going to be half in, half out, I don't want no siren people in ministry. Quit. You can quit today. Don't leave here lying. Reb said quit. I ain't saying quit. Reb saying quit playing. If you're going to play, quit. Tell him I said that. Now run and tell that. 2017, we ain't playing. God can't take us to another level. We acting like kindergarten. I got mad. I ain't sang my song. Woo, you need to know that you're the only one like to hear you sing. You need to know that. I'm out there. I ain't playing with folk. You want to play? They got playgrounds. Go to the mall. Salt stains. Remember, they're going to leave. If they can, they should. Yeah. And I even recommend you to some churches if you want to. Just come see me. Because God got more folk. I ain't playing with folk. I'm serious. I love you to death, but I love you too much for me to watch you be lazy, shiftless, and trifling. We can't go to the next level with you playing games. You're going to do something, do something. So do it. Be obedient. We tell somebody, everybody wearing white, here you come with cream, off beige, blue, purple. We ain't playing that. You know what white is. Listen, y'all, why sit, Mike? I'm going to look at you because you like me. Me and Mike go back to Central. We got secrets on each other. That's why we tight. Yeah, Mike was a good friend of Tony and Tyrone. I don't need to say nothing else. But Mike, why sit? I'm serious, y'all. Why sit at the same table with the same people that brings you to the same place? What place is that, Reverend? Loneliness. Now y'all know it's God's honest truth. I ain't never been there, thank God. But y'all know it loneliness may sting, but it's way worse to be lonely with a sucker sitting right there next to you. And you praying of ways that you can kill and it won't get traced. You just, Lord, reveal unto me how I can get rat poisoning in the meatloaf. Please, Lord, reveal. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Even if you don't kill them, Lord, mangle them where they can't talk and they can't tell what I just, you ain't got to kill them, just cripple them. Look, the same place, I mean, seriously, you sitting at the same table with the same people that's bringing you to the same place of poverty. You got 10 friends and can't come up with $100 between the 10 of you. The same place of rejection, the same place of drama, and some folk love drama so much they can't live without it. If everything going smooth, they don't know what to do. You let stuff start popping like popcorn. Now the adrenaline start flowing. Oh yeah, I like this. This is nasty and messy. People bring you to the point of fear, of uncertainty, guilt, depression, sadness, gloom, anger, anxiety, failure, and futility. Why are you sitting at the same table with the folk that's bringing you to the... And y'all calling Donald Trump crazy. And notice they critiquing who he getting around him. Y'all, look, he getting everybody around him with a billionaire. You think he going to get Ray? That makes sense. If he needs some of his friends, he can get some from them. Who are you hanging out? What can you get? They bad credit? Look, y'all, let me quote the president-elect. What in the Hades do you have to lose? The leper said, wait a minute, if we stay here, we're going to die. And if we go over there, we're going to die. So let's at least die trying to get something. You dying with nothing. In 2017, step out and see what the Lord will do. Exercise the faith that God has given you. Utilize the gifts of the Lord. Remember, he has embedded with you power enough to move mountains. He said, if you had faith as the size of a mustard seed, which ain't but this big, he said, you could say to that mountain, be cast into yonder sea, and the mountain will have to move. But you first of all got to know that you even have faith. Why do you keep driving on a dead-end road? They got signs that says no outlet. And you happy driving in circles. When you came in, it said no outlet. And you just run out of gas and know you ain't got no money to get none to the next fourth. And you just drive your gas out. And where did you go? In circles. And then you blame Iran for gas prices going up. Who told you to drive in circles? Lastly, y'all about I can tell when I get that like sick of me thing. I can see it. Y'all about sick of me. Now y'all love me, but right now you're sick of me. I know y'all love me. I don't have enemies. I got confused friends. But right now y'all ready for me to stop. But lastly, I see the givers rather than the takers. Finally, Darius, there are those who haven't stepped out in faith. They found an abundance. Perhaps you have eaten abundantly as the lepers did. Maybe you've been enriched spiritually with silver and gold from the word of God, but it's not enough for us, Trevon, to just gorge ourselves to death. Like the lepers, we have to realize that, wait a minute, it's some folk out there that don't have nothing. And I'm sitting in here satisfied, licking my fingers, talking about how good this rib sauce is, and that boy out there don't have nothing. I can't be satisfied until he tastes what I'm tasting. So wait a minute. Here I am feasting on God's goodness and other folk are starving to death. You see, I got all this love and I'm not sharing it with those who I'm criticizing for having hate. I got all this joy inside of me and I see folk that's all confused and pulling their hair out and I'm sitting over here laughing at them instead of sharing what I have with them. I got all of this peace and I see folk over there frustrated, don't know what to do, ready to cut their wrists, and I'm not offering them the peace that I have. I have all of this long suffering. I have all of this gentleness. I have all of this goodness. I got all of this faith. I got all this meekness. I got all this temperance. I need to share this with somebody. You need to say, God has been too good for me to be selfish on my own. And listen, when we say help somebody, it don't always have to be money, my brothers and my sisters. You remember Peter and John, and I'm closing now, when they were going to the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour, there was a lame man who was there, and he was begging, and he was asking alms of them, and everybody else was walking by them. Some people kept throwing him a nickel here, a dime there, and he was still crippled. And all of a sudden, Peter and John, who had been with Jesus, it said, and Peter fastened his eyes on him and Peter said, look at us. Now that's a curious command because the man had already gotten their attention, and now why would Peter say, look on us? What Peter said was, look here, man, if you want 50 cents, if you want a dollar, nickel and a quarter, you keep looking at them, but if you want your soul healed, you need to look at me. He said, listen here, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I you in the name of Jesus. You may not have silver and gold, but you need to tell somebody, baby, I might not have a checkbook, baby, I might not have a bank account, baby, I might not have money to give you, but oh, such as I have, I got a man named Jesus. I got power in me, I got deliverance in me, I got vision in me, I got mission in me, and baby, such as I have, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk out of your depression, rise up and walk out of that stuff. Rise, you need to offer them Jesus. Tell him he died on a hill called Calvary. Tell him he took nails in his hand. Tell him he took nails in his feet. Tell him he died. But don't forget to tell him that same Jesus rose from the dead, stood on resurrected ground, and declared all power of heaven and earth in my hand. Stop telling folk I can't help you. No, no, I can help you. But I got something better than paper. Because see, I can give you a dollar, and tomorrow you'll be back asking for somebody else. But I know a healer, and he can heal you when you won't have to come back and keep begging, and his name is Jesus. Take a chance. Step out. Say, Lord, listen. I'm making this decision based on my faith in you. I'm not the most intelligent person. I ain't got the most resources. I admit, dear Father, that I ain't the sharpest knife in the drawer, but I'm crazy enough to do one thing. I'm crazy enough to accept you at your word. You said your word would not return void. Father, I'm stepping out in the name of Jesus. Father, this is for your glory, not mine. I need you to make a way, Father, where there is no way. I need you to open the door for me. I need you to open the window for me, God. I'm stepping out on your word. If you knew all the answers, why would you need faith? I don't know how this thing gonna work, but I know one thing. God, you never made a mistake. You never failed. You still got all power. You still know everything. I'm rolling with Jesus. Now let me help you. When you roll with Jesus, now you're gonna leave some friends behind. Everybody don't want to go to Canaan. Some folk don't want to leave by the creek. I'm going to Canaan. See, everybody ain't. See, being unemployed don't bother some people. Boyfriend, girlfriend don't bother some people. Child, that's my boo. Well, if you got a... somebody call you that, that's a... What am I saying? Is it the sin not to have nothing? No. It's a sin not to want nothing. If you're going to roll with me, you need to want something. I want to be the owner. I want to do what the Bible says. I want to be the lender and not the borrower. And God will make you that if you step out on his word. Don't mean you ain't going to fall on the road. We all fall. But get back up and they say shake the. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. Folk may laugh at you. That's all right. See, you laughing because you are already at where you're going. See, I'm passing through. See, you already there. I'm going to Canaan, which is God's fair and happy lands where all his promises is. See, you happy and content talking about, do you want fries with that? I'm not. I may work that, but while I'm working that, I got my mind on owning a company. You think I'm just flipping French fries. I'm trying to flip in my mind, how can I put my name on the front of this building? How can I do this until I get this done? You can start anywhere, but you don't have to stay there. I want more for you in 2017. And I want more for me and my family. I want us to look like what the Bible says we ought to look like. Because right now I see a gap. And that's why our theme is filling in the gaps in our faith. I see a gap between what he said and what I see. And the gap is because of us. And you'll find out next week in Sunday school, he sent Timothy to Macedonia to strengthen their faith. And that's why I'm here. I'm going to push you. I'm going to shake you. I'm going to rock you. And the 12 can tell you, if I would have never pushed them with them lessons, this book would never be realized. I saw the potential in them. I'm not going to let them rest. And you're not going to be lazy and spiritually trifling around me, because I ain't. And if you're going to assist me, you got to be where I am. It would have never happened, Lisa, if I just let them, well, y'all just relax. They wondering, why in the world I got all these? They got about 700 books, don't you? 720. And they didn't know what I saw, Jones, in them. And some of them had to leave some stuff to get completed what they got completed. And God got most stuff for us to do, but we can't do it in the boat. Take a risk. You're taking one anyway. You got faith in the government. Why don't you put your faith in God? Step out, and he's going to do some great things. Why sit where you are at and die? The door of God's church is open. The door of God's church is open.